All right, I appreciate you guys letting me do this because I did the other one and the audio didn't come out right. So we're going to get started. And before we get started on the presentation, if you guys want to download this video to your channel, feel free to do it. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk about the debate that was held in the UK between, I believe it was Stephen Law. Yeah, Stephen Law and Dr. William Lane Craig. And I have the transcript of the debate here. So what I'm going to be going through is Craig's opening statements and his arguments. And the debate was on, does God exist? And so here we go. Now, it was hosted by Justin Briley, and he does a radio show. And he was the host, I believe, of it. And it was, I believe it was at Westminster Central Hall in October of 2011, if my memory serves me correctly. And so let's start now. So what I'm going to be doing now is I'm going to be explaining what Craig's arguments were for the existence of God. And he starts off like this. He says, in tonight's debate, I'm going to defend two basic contentions. Number one, there are good reasons to think that God exists. And two, there are not comparably good reasons to think that atheism is true. And then Craig says in his opening arguments, he says, now I'll leave it up to Dr. Law to present his arguments for atheism before I respond to them. In this opening speech, I want to sketch briefly three lines of evidence in favor of God's existence. Now, what I'm going to be doing, because I have the PowerPoint presentations, I'm going to actually give you four arguments for it. Craig says, I think that God makes sense of a wide range of the data of human experience, including philosophical, scientific, moral, and historical considerations. First thing Craig started off with was the origin of the universe. And he said, have you ever asked yourself where the universe came from? Did it have a beginning, or does it just go back and back forever? Typically, atheists have said that the universe is just eternal and uncaused. But there are good reasons, both philosophical and scientific, which call into question that assumption. Philosophically, the idea of an infinite past is very problematic. If the universe never had a beginning, then that means the number of past events in the history of the universe is infinite. But the real existence of an actually infinite number of things leads to metaphysical absurdities. And then what Craig does is he goes through some examples, which I think are very powerful, which shows that infinity is just an idea in our minds. Watch. He says, to give just one example, suppose you had an infinite number of coins numbered 1, 2, 3, and so on to infinity, and I took away all the odd-numbered coins. How many coins would you have left? Well, you'd still have all the even-numbered coins, or an infinity of coins. So infinity minus infinity is infinity. But now suppose instead that I took away all the coins numbered greater than 3. Now how many coins would you have left? Well, 3. So infinity minus infinity is 3. Now in each case, I took away an identical number of coins from an identical number of coins and came up with self-contradictory results. In fact, you can subtract infinity from infinity and get any answer from 0 to infinity. It is for this reason inverse operations like subtraction and division are simply prohibited in transfinite arithmetic. But in the real world, such a convention has no sway. Obviously, you can give away whatever coins you want. Here's another example of the absurdity of an infinite past. Take the planets Jupiter and Saturn. Suppose that for every orbit that Saturn completes around the Sun, the planet Jupiter completes 2. If Saturn has completed 10 orbits, Jupiter has completed 20. If Saturn has completed 1 trillion, Jupiter has completed 2 trillion. The longer they orbit, the farther Saturn falls behind. If they continue to orbit forever, they will approach a limit at which Saturn is infinitely far behind Jupiter. But now turn the story around. Suppose Jupiter and Saturn have been orbiting the Sun from eternity past. Now which one will have completed the most orbits? Well, the correct mathematical answer is that the number of their orbits is identical. But that seems absurd. For the longer they orbit, the greater the disparity between them grows. So how does the number of their orbits magically become identical simply by making them orbit from eternity past? These and many other examples suggest that infinity is just an idea in your mind, not something that exists in reality. But that entails that since past events are not just ideas but are real, the number of past events must be finite. Therefore, the series of past events can't go back and back forever. Rather, the universe must have begun to exist. This purely philosophical conclusion has been confirmed by remarkable discoveries in astronomy and astrophysics. We now have pretty strong evidence that the universe is not eternal in the past, but had an absolute beginning a finite time ago. In the year 2003, Arvin Bord, Alan Guth, and Alexander Vilenkin were able to prove that any universe which is on average in a state of cosmic expansion throughout its history cannot be infinite in the past, but must have a past space-time boundary. What makes their proof so powerful is that it holds regardless of the physical description of the early universe. Because we don't yet have a quantum theory of gravity, we can't yet provide a physical description of the first split second of the universe. But the Bord-Guth-Vilenkin theorem is independent of any physical description of that moment. Their theorem implies that the quantum vacuum state of the early universe, which some scientific popularizers, have misleadingly and inaccurately referred to as nothing, cannot be eternal in the past, but must have had an absolute beginning. Even if our universe is just a tiny part of a so-called multiverse composed of many universes, their theorem requires that the multiverse itself must have an absolute beginning. Of course, highly speculative scenarios such as loop quantum gravity models, string models, even closed time-like curves have been proposed to try to avoid this absolute beginning. Now, these models are all fraught with problems, but the bottom line is that none of these theories, get this guys, none of these theories, even if they were true, succeeds in restoring an eternal past. At most, they just push the beginning back a step. But then the inevitable question arises. Why did the universe come into being? What brought the universe into existence? Some intrepid atheists have asserted that the universe just popped into being without a cause. But surely that's metaphysically impossible. For such a conclusion is, in the words of philosopher of science Bernulf Kanitschneider, in head-on collision with the most successful ontological commitment in the history of science, namely the metaphysical principle that out of nothing, nothing comes. So why does the universe exist instead of just nothing? Where did it come from? There must have been a transcendent cause which brought the universe into being. We can summarize our arguments thus far as follows. The universe began to exist. If the universe began to exist, then the universe has a transcendent cause. Therefore, the universe has a transcendent cause. Whatever begins to exist has a cause. The universe began to exist. And I'm going through the slide now. Therefore, the universe has a cause. Given the truth of these premises, the conclusion necessarily follows. Now, from the very nature of the case, this cause must be uncaused, changeless, timeless, and immaterial being which created the universe. It must be uncaused because we've seen that there cannot be an infinite regress of causes. It must be timeless and therefore changeless, at least without the universe, because it created time. Because it also created space, it must transcend space as well and therefore be immaterial, not physical. Now, there are only two possible candidates that could fit such a description. Either an abstract object, like a number, or an unembodied mind or consciousness. But abstract objects don't stand in causal relations. The number 7, for example, can't cause anything. Therefore, it follows that the transcendent cause of the universe is an unembodied mind, and thus we are brought not merely to an uncaused cause of the universe, but to its personal creator. Now, in the debate with Stephen Law, I don't think Craig brought up the fine-tuning, but he does sometimes, so I'll go through this because he didn't have this in his transcript. The fine-tuning, in my opinion, is just amazing. To me, I just can't believe that the universe was fine-tuned for life for right here on Earth by dumb luck or chance. And basically, if you want to get a list of these fine-tuned constants, I guess I should tell you what it is. Oh, hey, John. Good to see you again. John wants to know what fine-tuning is, and I'll tell you where you can get the list. If you go to www.shakanow.net below this video, you'll see – oh, and by the way, click links, L-I-N-K-S. You'll see a list of 50 life-permitting constants. And what these constants are is, for example, I'll go through some of them, like the gravitational constant, the speed of light, Boltzmann's constant. And it's so fine-tuned for life. Literally, if I could change one of those just a hair's breadth, you could destroy life. We're literally living on a razor's edge. There's only three possible reasons for this remarkable fine-tuning, and scientists have been shocked to discover this fine-tuning. There's only three reasons. Either number one, dumb luck or chance, or number two, physical necessity. In other words, could there be something in natural law that would cause these constants to be fine-tuned like that? Well, they haven't found anything in these constants that would cause them to be fine-tuned in natural law. For example, the fine-tuning is of two sorts. And I'm doing a presentation now, but someone in the chat, John Anthony, asked me, what is the fine-tuning? Here's what it is, John Anthony. And John Anthony, you could feel free to download this video, put it on your YouTube channel, because I know you're a creationist. First, when the laws of nature are expressed as mathematical equations, you find appearing in them certain constants, like the gravitational constant. Now, John, these constants are not determined by the laws of nature. So we can't say that the fine-tuning is due to physical necessity, because the laws of nature are consistent with a wide range of values for these constants. Second, in addition to these constants, there are certain arbitrary quantities put in as initial conditions on which the laws of nature operate. It's like what we just talked about earlier. It's like an intelligent mind fine-tuned it for life. For example, the amount of entropy, or the balance between matter and antimatter in the universe. And all of these quantities, guys, there's like 50 life-permitting ones, they fall into an extraordinarily narrow range of life-permitting values. And get this, this is what's so amazing. Were these constants or quantities to be altered by less than a hair's breadth, the balance would be destroyed and life would not exist. Let me give you another example. The atomic weak force. Are you sitting down, guys? Get this. This is clearly reeks of intelligent design. If it were altered by as little as one part out of 10 to the 100th power, it would not have permitted a life-permitting universe. I used to be an atheist, but after looking at these arguments and researching the historical person of Jesus Christ, I have left atheism. I'm now a Christian. No one could ever convince me that it is rational to believe that not one, not two, not five, not 10, not 20, not 30, but 50 constants were fine-tuned all by nothing. Well, it can't be due to dumb luck or chance. It can't be due to physical necessity, but there's only three possible explanations for this remarkable fine-tuning: physical necessity, dumb luck and chance, or design. We know it can't be due to physical necessity because the constants and quantities are independent of the laws of nature. In fact, string theory predicts that there are around 10, get this guys, 10 to the 500th power different possible universes that are consistent with nature's laws. Well, what about dumb luck and chance? Could the fine-tuning be due to dumb luck and chance? Well, the problem with that alternative is that the odds against the fine-tunings occurring by accident are so incomprehensibly great, they cannot be reasonably faced. The probability that all constants and quantities would fall by chance alone into the infinitesimal life-permitting range is vanishingly small. And we know that chance doesn't cause things. Chance cannot create a fine-tuned universe. We know that life-prohibiting universes are vastly more probable than any life-permitting universe. So if the universe were the product of chance, the odds are overwhelming that it would be life-permitting. The fine-tuning of the universe is therefore plausibly due neither to physical necessity or dumb luck or chance. It therefore follows logically that the best explanation, thus the teleological argument, gives us an intelligent designer of the cosmos. All right, let's go to the next argument, guys. We're going to go now to objective moral values. We have two more arguments to go on. Now, before we go to objective moral values, let's wrap up what we just talked about. We talked about the fine-tuning, the creation of the universe out of nothing. And so we're brought not merely to an uncaused cause of the universe, but to its personal creator. Now, our first arguments that we just went through give us a transcendent personal creator of the universe, but it doesn't tell us anything about his moral character. How can we know then that he is good? How can we know that he is good? This argument addresses that question. Number one, if God did not exist, objective moral values and duties would not exist. Now, by objective moral values, I mean values which are valid and binding whether people believe in them or not. And let me just go a little bit further here, even though this is not on the transcript. Let me elaborate. To say that what the Nazis did was evil and wrong is to say that it was wrong even if the Nazis were able to kill everyone that disagreed with them to where the only people that were left were people that were Nazis themselves. So what we mean by objective moral values are values which are valid and binding whether people believe in them or not. And many theists and atheists agree on this, that if God does not exist, then moral values and duties are not objective in this sense. For example, Michael Ruse, an agnostic philosopher of science, here's what Michael Ruse said. He said, morality is a biological adaptation no less than our hands and feet and teeth. Considered as a rationally justifiable set of claims about an objective something, ethics is illusory. Morality is just an aid to survival and reproduction. And he says, an any deeper meaning is illusory. Now, on a naturalistic view, moral values are just the byproduct of biological evolution and social conditioning. Just as a troop of baboons will exhibit cooperative and even self-sacrificial behavior because natural selection has determined it to be advantageous in the struggle for survival, so their primate cousins, Homo sapiens, have developed similar behavior for the same reason. As a result of socio-biological pressures, there has emerged among Homo sapiens a sort of herd morality which functions well in the perpetuation of our species. Now, this is what the evolutionists, Michael Ruse and people like that, this is what they're positing, what they believe. But here's a problem with this. On the atheistic view, there doesn't seem to be anything about this morality that makes it objectively binding and true. How could it be? Certain actions such as rape may not be socially advantageous, and so in the course of human development have become taboo. But that does absolutely nothing to show that rape is wrong. Such behavior goes on all the time in the animal kingdom. Given atheism, the rapist who chooses to flout the herd morality is doing nothing more serious than acting unfashionably, sort of the moral equivalent of Lady Gaga, out of the step with the herd. But this leads to our second premise. Objective moral values and duties do exist. In moral experience, we apprehend a realm of moral values and duties that impose themselves upon us. As philosopher Louis Antony so nicely puts it, any argument for moral skepticism is going to depend upon premises which are less obvious than the reality of objective moral values themselves. Now, here's what's really interesting. There are atheists that admit objective moral values exist. Look what Dr. Craig says. He says, I was gratified to see that in his published work, Dr. Law affirms the existence of objective moral values, such as tolerance and open-mindedness. Dr. Law rejects relativism. And I quote him, he rejects, quote, politically correct twaddle of a rather noxious sort, unquote. Well, rightly so. Actions like rape, cruelty, racial hatred, and child abuse aren't just socially unacceptable behavior. They're truly evil. Michael Ruse himself admits the man who says it's morally acceptable to rape is just as mistaken as the man who says 2 + 2 = 5. Some things, at least, are truly evil. But if that is the case, then it follows logically and inescapably that therefore God exists. You know, some people think that evil in the world provides overwhelming evidence against the existence of God. I think the exact opposite is true. Real evil in the world actually serves to prove the existence of God, since without God to ground objective moral values, good and evil as such would not exist. Objective moral values do exist. It follows logically and inescapably, therefore, that God exists. So now let's talk about the historical facts concerning Jesus of Nazareth. Can I tell you guys something? This isn't part of the transcript, but I got to tell you this. I thought I'd throw this in. When I was an atheist, I would hey, John, how you doing, guys? I'm just looking in the chat right now. When I was an atheist, you know, I was reading the Bible, and there was one part that really moved me, and it's the part before Jesus is ready to be killed. You know, he's ready to go to the cross, and he sits down with his disciples, and he says to them, hey, look, before now I've called you, he called them his disciples. And then he says, and I could just picture it, he says, but now I call you my friends, because there's no greater gift than to lay down one's life for one's friends. And that really moved me. I could picture them there. Jesus knows that what he's got to do, and he sits down with them and he tells them, look, you know, before now you were my disciples, but now I call you my friends. And that's what Jesus Christ did for us, is he brings us into friendship with God. So let's go through the historical facts concerning Jesus of Nazareth. Our case so far gives us a generic monotheism affirmed by Jews, Christians, and Muslims alike. But do we know anything more about who this God is? Well, to answer that question, we have to look at the person of Jesus of Nazareth, the most famous, most epic, most well-known person in world history. Number one book in the world, the Bible. So let's start with the most famous person in world history and the number one book, the Bible. The historical person, Jesus of Nazareth, was, by all accounts, a remarkable individual when he walked the earth here in the flesh. Now, Stephen Law, this is what's really interesting. Stephen Law had said, well, he doesn't believe Jesus of Nazareth even existed, which is amazing, because even Richard Dawkins, who I know Richard Dawkins used to be an atheist, he's an agnostic now. He now says he's an agnostic. Even the agnostic Richard Dawkins admits that Jesus of Nazareth existed. If you go to my website right below this video at shotgunnow.net and click music podcast, you can download for free the entire video of John Lennox and agnostic Richard Dawkins debating. And Richard Dawkins gets schooled by John Lennox. And John Lennox says, you know, Richard, in your books, you talked about how Jesus never existed. And you know, Richard, that bothered me that you would say that. That's not true. And there's a very embarrassing moment in the debate where you could tell Dawkins knows that he's getting destroyed in that debate. Critics of that debate said John Lennox totally destroyed him. But you know what? I got to credit agnostic Richard Dawkins. The agnostic Richard Dawkins said, okay, well, you know, maybe I misspoke. Jesus did exist. And he flip-flopped right in the debate, and he conceded that Jesus of Nazareth did exist. Now, I don't agree with agnostic Richard Dawkins on a lot of things that he says, but I will give him credit where credit was due. I applaud Richard Dawkins for doing what I did, coming around to rational thinking and reality and truth, and admitting that Jesus of Nazareth is a historical person. But Dr. Law, Stephen Law, was saying that Jesus of Nazareth never existed, which is pretty bizarre, because historians have reached something of a consensus that Jesus came onto the scene with an unprecedented sense of divine authority, the authority to stand and speak in God's place. He claimed that in himself the kingdom of God had arrived. And as visible demonstrations of this fact, he carried out a ministry of miracle working and exorcisms. But the supreme confirmation of his claim was his resurrection from the dead. Now, most people would think that the resurrection of Jesus is something you just believe in by faith or not. But there are actually three established facts recognized by the majority of the New Testament historians today, which I believe are best explained by the resurrection of Jesus. Fact number one. On the Sunday after his crucifixion, Jesus' tomb was found empty by a group of his women followers. Fact number two. On separate occasions, different individuals and groups saw appearances of Jesus alive after his death. And number three, the original disciples suddenly came to believe in the resurrection of Jesus despite having every predisposition to the contrary. N.T. Wright, an eminent New Testament scholar, concludes, quote, "That is why, as a historian, I cannot explain the rise of early Christianity unless Jesus rose again, leaving an empty tomb behind him," unquote. Attempts to explain away these three great facts, like the disciples stole the body, or Jesus wasn't really dead, have been universally rejected by contemporary scholarship. The simple fact is that there just is no plausible naturalistic explanation of these three facts, and therefore it seems to me the Christian is amply justified in believing that the best explanation of the evidence is that Jesus rose from the dead and was who he claimed to be. But that entails that the God revealed by Jesus of Nazareth exists. And thus we have a good inductive argument for the existence of God based on the resurrection of Jesus. In summary, then, we presented tonight a cumulative case based on the origin of the universe, the existence of objective moral values and duties, the fine-tuned universe, the teleological argument, and the resurrection of Jesus. For thinking that the God of Israel, the God revealed by Jesus of Nazareth, exists. If atheism wants us to believe otherwise, that atheism is true, atheism must first tear down all of these arguments that I presented and in their place erect a case of its own to prove that God does not exist. Unless and until atheism does that, I think it's obviously clear that Christian theism is the more plausible worldview. Now, I have some other things to say because I'm done with the presentation, but I want to give you guys some personal testimony here of another reason why I left atheism. You know, when you study the history of atheism and its violent past, you know atheism is responsible for over 100 million murders and brutal rapes under the evil atheist regimes of Stalin, Pol Pot, Mao, the Kim Jong-il, Khmer Rouge. Osama bin Laden, in his most evil dreams, as he slides his hands back and forth plotting evil, could not murder the amount of people that the atheist regimes have. A pile of bodies higher than the Twin Towers combined. Another problem with atheism that I see is the constant contradictions. When I was in atheism, some of my friends would say that it's possible for God to exist, and they were calling themselves atheists. And then I had some friends that would call themselves agnostics, like Richard Dawkins, and they would claim that it's possible for God to exist. And then I have atheist friends and other atheist friends, and they were claiming that it's impossible for God to exist. But when I became a Christian, they gave one message: God exists. Anyone that opens up the Bible clearly would see that it just proclaims God exists. So Christianity is rationally true. It doesn't have this contradiction, God doesn't exist, or it's possible or impossible. It simply claims God exists. But atheism can never be true, because what we hear coming out of atheism is that it's possible for God to exist. But we also hear that it's impossible for God to exist. If it contradicts itself like atheism does, it cannot be true. Now, another thing, too, which just recently happened, and of course I became a Christian before this happened, but now you have the number one atheist in the world, Richard Dawkins, now conceding that he's an agnostic now. He's an agnostic. In a recent debate, someone asked him, well, because he was saying that it is possible that God can't exist. And they said, well, why don't you call yourself an agnostic? And Richard Dawkins says, I do. And then the moderator said, well, wait a minute, you're known world over as, like, you know, an atheist. You know, that's what they're calling you. And Richard Dawkins says, well, I don't call myself that. Richard Dawkins, the number one most famous atheist in the world, is now an agnostic. This should really show us really the madness of atheism. So you got the real evil history of atheism. Another thing, too, is the high suicide rate. Atheists have one of the highest suicide rates in the world. You don't kill yourself if you're happy. People that are depressed and sad kill themselves. And atheism has one of the highest suicide rates in the world. You know, after 9/11, here's some more information. After 9/11, they did a recent study on they wanted to see who was the most trusted group in society. And right after 9/11, they did this, and they wanted to see if people trusted Muslims. And so what they did is they interviewed all these people, and you'll be surprised, and you could actually do a search on the internet, type in atheist least trusted. And shockingly, what happened is, even after 9/11, where you would think people would distrust Muslims and stuff, the Muslims were more trusted than atheists. In fact, it was the Christians, you know, sort of at the top, the people, you know, Christians, Catholics, Protestants, you know, and then further down you'd have Mormons and stuff like that. And then as you went down the list towards the least trusted, it was then the homosexual community was down there towards the end. But the bottom rung of the ladder, oh, and by the way, the Muslims were higher up. They were even higher than the atheists, which was surprising to me, because I thought, uh-oh, you know, probably what's going to happen is now everyone's going to have this fear of Muslims right after 9/11, right? But to my surprise, atheists fared worse than the Muslims. The Muslims were like the third least trusted. It was Muslims, then underneath was the homosexual community, and then the bottom rung, the bottom of the barrel, was atheist. Was atheist. Even Sam Harris is advocating that people no longer, that his atheist friends and all atheists no longer call themselves atheists because of the horrible reputation that atheism has in society. Well, come on, my atheist friends, you reap what you sow. If you go around saying that rape is subjective and it's not objectively wrong, you reap what you sow. If you go around saying there is no such thing as good or evil, hey, you reap what you sow. Richard Dawkins had said there's no such thing as good, there's no such thing as evil, there's no purpose to life, there's nothing but blind, pitiless indifference. This is why atheists are the least trusted group in society. Hey, you reap what you sow. The last thing I'll say about atheism is it offers no purpose, no reason, and no rational purpose to life. For example, on atheism, they believe they're just animals, that they're here just to live and then to die. The atheist can have no objective purpose to their life. They're just existing. The thing that doesn't make sense to me is, then why would atheists try to get us involved with atheism? To me, it all boils down to a question of life or death. On atheism, the best thing it could offer you is death, because it always ends in death. There's no purpose to life. You just are born and then you just die. That's the atheist worldview. But on Christianity, it's all about life. Yeah, Jesus said, I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. So as an ex-atheist, now Christian, I would encourage people, don't embrace death, embrace life. Reject the evil of atheism and accept the good of Jesus Christ and embrace life. So thanks for watching, guys. Feel free to download this video. And then also, if you look below the video, you can go to shotgunnow.net and click links, L-I-N-K-S, and there's a list there of the fine-tuned constants. You also can click debates, and I have a new page there that we've added where you can watch debates, like the one I was telling you about that agnostic Richard Dawkins lost, and also you can see Christopher Hitchens lose in debate to Dr. William Lane Craig. Oh, did you guys see the debate where, and I got that right below this video at shotgunnow.net when you go to the debates page. You know, when Craig was asking Hitchens, you know, give me some arguments. Why should we believe atheism is true? You know, Hitchens didn't have any arguments at all. I mean, none. So I say go with the view that has proof and evidence. You know, the Atheist Experience Show has been asked a gazillion times, provide proof and evidence that atheism is accurate and correct. I'll put that video below this video. All they did was talk about a unicorn in a box. Well, we've asked the number one atheist on YouTube. I don't know if he's an atheist or an agnostic now, the Amazing Atheist. And he was honest. He said he cannot provide proof and evidence that atheism is true. Folks, I don't have enough blind faith to be an atheist. Go where the proof and evidence is at. Become a Christian. God bless you guys. Thanks for watching.